to make us go live on the internet. There we go. Welcome, everyone, to the final Friday seminar of winter term. Glad to see you all here. We're going to have, I think, a really interesting talk and discussion today. I see a few new faces. So I want to remind everyone and inform the folks who may be new to the Friday seminar that we are webcasting the seminar, and therefore, when we get to the point where you can ask questions, we need you to use the microphone to ask the questions so the people who are on the web can hear. And on most of your desks, there are microphones. What you need to do is hold the touch button down, keep the red light lit while you are asking the questions so the people on the web, both live and archived for years and years to come, can hear your very insightful, thought-provoking question. If for some reason the microphone isn't working or you don't have one, I or someone else will come and give you this handy-dandy portable mic. Okay, so without further ado, I'm going to introduce our speaker. Our speaker today is Adonia E. Lugo. She's a doctoral candidate in anthropology at the University of California, Irvine. Go Anteaters. She uses ethnographic engagement as a researcher and advocate to make our cities socially just, sustainable, and bike-friendly. The co-founder of City Lights Ciudad de Luces.
Ciudad de Luces, yeah.
It's been a long time since I took my Spanish. And Cicla Via in Los Angeles. She's currently writing a dissertation about bikes, bodies, and public space, which is what she's going to talk about today. Adonia blogs about car-free life at urbanadonia.blogspot.com, and she currently lives in Seattle, which is one reason she's visiting us today. Take it away.
Great. Thanks so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here talking to an urban planning audience. So I guess I should just get started. In October 2009, I biked with friends to a library in South Los Angeles to attend a public workshop being held as part of the LA Department of Transportation's bike plan update process. The usual crowd of bike advocates milled around, talking to Department of Transportation staff and planners from Alta Planning and Design, who had been contracted to update the plan. We were encouraged to draw on maps, make comments on plan language, and submit comment cards. Few people made comments on the portion of the map representing the historically black and Latino neighborhood we were standing in, presumably because most of us lived in other parts of the city. Outside the window, I saw several people of color biking down busy Western Avenue on the sidewalk. Last Friday, I interviewed a prominent figure in Seattle's Filipino-American community and asked her to define a bicyclist. A bicyclist is a white man, she said, who rides along with arrogance and entitled attitude as though he owns the road. He has an expensive bike, a funky helmet, and he knows how to use a bicycle really well. She had mentioned seeing people of color riding bikes, and I asked what she would call them. People who ride bikes, she said, not bicyclists. City efforts to include the public in planning decisions for bike projects often rely on participation from bike movements. If these movements do not connect with regular people who ride bikes, such as individuals biking out of economic necessity, the bike infrastructure projects they promote may be perceived as serving only a privileged few. The intended effect of installing bike infrastructure in historically low-income or otherwise marginalized communities may be to encourage a diverse range of people to start commuting by bike, but if a community does not imagine themselves to be bike commuters, does the presence of a bike lane or a bike path where they see outsiders passing through their neighborhood suddenly convert them to the cause? Furthermore, as green amenities that boost property values, projects such as bike lanes and off-street paths may get blamed for displacing low-income renters. Based on my ethnographic research on bicycling in Los Angeles, I propose that an intermediary step of building human infrastructure should precede the installation of permanent bike facilities. From September 2008 to January 2011, I participated in two projects that aimed to support bicycling in diverse low-income communities in Los Angeles. One project, City of Lights, or Ciudad de Luces in Spanish, started as a bike light distribution program targeting Latino cyclists and grew into a bike repair cooperative housed at a day laborer center in downtown Los Angeles. The other project, Ciclavia, organized a ciclovia, or street closure event, through central LA's densely populated and ethnically diverse neighborhoods. Collaborating on these efforts showed me the gaps between bike planning and the people we wanted to include, and suggested ways LA could contribute to building a broader bike movement. Returning to the term bicyclist, I think it is important that we stretch the term to fit more uses of bicycles as part of making bicycling an accepted mode of transport in the United States. For that reason, in this talk, I refer to people who ride bikes as bicyclists, whether they would self-apply this term or not. So a little note on my methods here, since I'm coming from anthropology. Anthropology's ethnographic method involves spending time living among the cultural group under study, allowing the researcher to cross the line between theoretical frameworks and everyday life. To investigate the production of knowledge in urban planning, I followed designs for public space from subcultural circles to city planning meetings, observing bike advocates' impact on policy agendas in Los Angeles. My methods involve taking notes, occasionally doing interviews, and riding a bike all over the place in the tradition of situationism psychogeographic drift. My dissertation is engaged research, which Charles Hale describes as emerging not through some idealized fit between activism and scholarship, but rather through engagement with their multiple contradictions, end quote. In my case, this kind of engagement meant designing urban projects rather than primarily observing them or measuring their outcomes. I found the support to experiment across the lines of community-based research in both urban planning and in anthropology. Through UC Irvine's Community Outreach Partnership Center, I completed a research internship with the Los Angeles County Bicycle Coalition in 2008 and 2009, working alongside urban planning students completing their thesis projects. Now, as I write up my dissertation, I'm looking for ways to connect my research with the more quantitative approach common in transportation planning. I feel pretty fortunate to have this opportunity to speak to an audience of transportation planning students, and I hope you can comment afterwards about where ethnographic research might fit into the project of designing and planning sustainable and equitable cities. And now I'm going to drink some water before I go to my next part, because I can hear my voice starting to gum up. Okie doke. Imagining that place comes from developments rather than from the actions of people sets the stage for disruptive changes to existing communities because it does not take the impact of social life on place into account. Many people think of Los Angeles as a place where driving is the only way to get around. The near-complete dominance ceded to the automobile in American public space frames walking, using public transit, and bicycling as unusual transport choices. The lack of a car can be enough to mark people as undesirable in Los Angeles. As anthropologist Sarah Jane has noted, increasingly those unable to drive have been seen as disabled. Automobility did not affect all communities equally, and in Los Angeles, car ownership signifies social power. Transportation infrastructure such as highways and five-lane streets through residential neighborhoods reinforce the desirability of driving over other modes of transport. Streets designed to accommodate motorists above other users have the effect of keeping people apart, of keeping certain bodies in certain neighborhoods and out of others. If we think of bike infrastructure as the primary means of encouraging transport cycling, this would mean that LA has a very long way to go before bicycling is possible there. In fact, many people get around Los Angeles on buses, trains, and bikes. The local transit authority has the second highest transit load in the country after New York City. The people I knew who got around on bikes in LA lived in central neighborhoods that were developed when LA was navigable by the country's most extensive network of streetcars. In other words, they lived in the parts of LA that predate suburban sprawl and are easy to get around on a bike. Writing in 1960, planning theorist Kevin Lynch noted that, except by minute attention to plant types or to the distant background, it would be hard to distinguish downtown Los Angeles from the center of many U.S. cities. There is the same piling up of blank office structures, the same ubiquity of traffic ways and parking lots. As people spent more and more time in their cars, this urban core of Los Angeles was simply raised as a health hazard, like the Bunker Hill neighborhood, or left to deteriorate into slums. Laura Pulido characterized this area in racial terms, describing the discriminatory practices of redlining that encouraged an outmigration of whites from central Los Angeles. Whites took advantage of new, high-quality, inexpensive, subsidized housing in the suburbs, while people of color remained largely concentrated in the core of Los Angeles, end quote. This area has been largely ignored in writing that portrays LA as a postmodern exception to older forms of American urbanism. Architectural critic Rainer Banham, in his influential 1971 book, Los Angeles, The Architecture of Four Ecologies, included a picture of the view looking south from the Griffith Observatory in the Hollywood Hills, commenting that the great size and lack of distinction of the area covered by this prospect make it the area where Los Angeles is least distinctively itself. One of the reasons why the great plains of it, as he called them, are so daunting is that this is where Los Angeles is the most like other cities. Anywheresville, Nowheresville. So this is the shot from his book. The spine of the book kind of gets in the center of the photo, but you get the general idea. You see these gridded neighborhoods, and then the pileup of buildings in the distance is along Wilshire Boulevard. Coincidentally, while I lived in Los Angeles, my blog masthead showed the opposite perspective of this view, staring up at Griffith Park from the Equitable Building on Wilshire between Vermont and Normandy. The Equitable Building is the big black rectangle at the top in the center there. So this is what my blog masthead looked like, where I was in that building looking back in the opposite direction. And this is just that neighborhood in a larger shot. This densely populated, ethnically diverse core of LA is where bicycling social worlds have flourished, fostered by a local ecological movement that works to demonstrate that sustainable living is possible even in the heart of car culture. Living and researching in this area encouraged me to question the importance of bike infrastructure. Riding a bike in LA showed how malleable the city is, despite endless concrete designed to channel automotive flows. So I think for a lot of people who are unfamiliar with biking in LA and are mostly used to driving there, this is what they imagine biking there must be like. You're on a really busy street, this is Wilshire Boulevard, you're crowded out by cars, you know, there's nothing like a bike lane, you've got weird uneven concrete there. But in reality, a lot of biking in LA looks like this, where because you're in a gridded zone, you can stay off of major streets but continue parallel to them, not unlike the bike boulevard system here in Portland. Of course, these are unofficial routes, but bicyclists talk to each other about them. I found bike infrastructure to be a social phenomenon as well as a physical one. The immigrant cyclists I worked with during my fieldwork usually rode on sidewalks on commercial streets, while my bike activist interlocutors tended to ride in the street through residential neighborhoods like this. This suggests that bicyclists' perceptions of where it is appropriate to ride are influenced not just by infrastructure, but also by participation in particular communities. Individual trajectories do not happen in a vacuum. They negotiate existing built forms, habits, and the ongoing movements of others. Our mobilities leave traces on the city that shape immediate and future mobilities for other individuals. Thinking about infrastructure differently can contribute to our understandings of how cities work and how we can make them work better for a diverse population. From an ethnographic perspective, what matters about infrastructure is its impact on social life. And in fact, there are forms of infrastructure that can be located only in social life. Infrastructure made through human action can help people survive where outside support fails. The writer Abdoumalik Simone has noted that in a city like Kinshasa, people themselves are the important infrastructure. In other words, their selves, situations, and bodies bear the responsibility for articulating different locations, resources, and stories into viable opportunities for everyday survival, end quote. Also writing about Kinshasa, Philip Debeck observed that infrastructural fragments enable the creation of new social spaces. Instead of considering mobility to be an individual engagement with infrastructure, looking for human infrastructure means examining the social life of mobility. Instead of requiring official sanction, human infrastructure grows through community-based projects. Where physical infrastructure for biking may be lacking, people draw on their experiences biking in other cities or find friends who show them ways to avoid danger. Examples of human infrastructure in bicycling include group rides that create temporary spaces where bicycling becomes normal, online communities where riders share knowledge, hand signals between road users, and bike repair cooperatives. Another important form of human infrastructure for bicycling is what Peter Jacobson called safety in numbers. Bodies in the street create a safer environment. This is not an exhaustive list, but is meant to illustrate the breadth of ways that human infrastructure is integrated into the experience of bicycling. Now I'm going to talk about my two experiments with observing and building human infrastructure for biking in LA. So while I talk about City Lights, I'm going to show videos from the program from 2009. Let's see if I can make this work right. Warp. All right. The racialized dehumanization of bodies outside of cars in Los Angeles has contributed to understandings of public transit there as a civil rights issue, with a movement for transit justice confronting discrimination in transportation. The most famous example of this discourse's challenge to perceived racism in transportation in LA has been the work of the Bus Riders Union. The BRU successfully sued Metro in 1994 over the funneling of transportation money to rail projects rather than bus service, even though 94% of Metro's users rode the bus. Transit Justice draws on the civil rights legacy of organizing transit riders. There's been little discussion of bike justice, even though biking is not just another mode of transport. In an automobilized landscape, it is a transgressive act that opens the individual cyclist to harassment and threats to personal safety. The first time I attended a public hearing about bike infrastructure in January 2008, I learned that designating a street as a municipal bike route seemed like a threat to that street's residents. It was not bicycling they objected to, these Long Beach homeowners stated over and over, who didn't enjoy taking their cruiser out for a ride along the beach path. Other cyclists should do what they did and ride down there. Only a few blocks west of this proposed route, the beachfront path was a crowded, winding strip that could only be reached by going down a steep hill. It was not useful for transport. Making their street a bike route would attract undesirables who would camp out, the homeowners said. Similarly, as reported by Carrie Brondo and others, residents in Memphis feared that a bike path would become a superhighway for drugs and crime. Despite characterizations such as these, bicycling is not discussed as a civil rights issue because bicyclists, in the narrow sense, does not include people who bike out of necessity. In the United States, bicycling was long the practice of eccentric enthusiasts, a status sport, or a mode of transport for those too poor or too young to drive cars. Most of the work on bikes and culture has focused on users who self-identify as cyclists and organize themselves into subcultural groups. While these activist cyclists play an important part in the bicycle world of Los Angeles, another type of bicyclist is common. What Dan Capel and others have termed invisible riders are often low-income, usually Latino or African-American men who bike out of economic necessity. They have been largely invisible to official research as well. It is these cyclists that homeowners associations have in mind when they fight municipal rights to install transit, bike, and pedestrian infrastructure in their neighborhoods. For example, the terms car-free and transit-dependent have very different connotations, with the former implying a celebration of sustainable transport and the latter referring to poverty and its associated pressures. Similar distinctions play out in bicycling as well. In October 2008, I started collaborating with Allison Manos, then an intern at the Los Angeles County Bicycle Coalition, on a campaign to connect low-income Spanish-speaking cyclists with the bike movement. For me, it was a cultural experiment. Could bicyclists riding for different reasons come together around their shared practice? By designing a volunteer-based outreach campaign, we would be sending visible cyclists out to talk to invisible cyclists. For Allison, it was a means to include an overlooked population in urban planning for bicycling. By reaching out to invisible cyclists, the Bike Coalition could better represent their needs to city officials and planners. We started with a donation of 100 lights from Planet Bike, Department of Transportation pamphlets about cyclists' right to the road, and a small card in Spanish explaining the Bike Coalition's mission. With the help of bilingual community organizer Andy Rodriguez, who's actually that guy, we started handing out these bundles to cyclists we saw riding without lights near transit stations. We recruited volunteers through the Bike Coalition to distribute our first batch of lights, but we quickly realized that we had little hope of forging lasting links with the men we were interacting with in passing. Many immigrant cyclists received services from organizations focused on supporting workers and the Latino community, but these organizations had no ties to bike groups. What if we used a pre-existing organization as a distribution point? So in April 2009, Allison and I met with Jose Veliz, who worked at a day laborer center run by the Central American Resource Center, or CARECEN, which is an immigrants' rights organization. CARECEN invited us to use their worker center near MacArthur Park in central LA as a staging ground for light distribution and safety workshops. And that's where this footage is from. It's from the CARECEN Center. Joined by Bike Coalition staffer Dorothy Lay, we started spending a few hours there every Friday, installing bike lights and chatting with day laborer cyclists. There, I learned a different perspective on biking in LA. For some of these cyclists, the sidewalks of LA represented a vast improvement over biking on streets with no sidewalks at all. One man told me that biking here was much better than biking in Guatemala City. Other people wished to avoid attracting attention from police, who sometimes wrote tickets to these men for not wearing helmets, even though LA does not have a mandatory helmet law for adults. In some cases, we could see why they avoided riding in traffic as soon as we looked at their bikes. One person had been riding without his seat post locked into place. Others rode on tires without tubes inside them, and many had bikes that did not fit them comfortably. Riding slowly on sidewalks made commuting on these broken machines possible. In the midst of this organizing, City of Lights experienced a setback when a national bicycling and walking advocacy organization rejected a grant application on the grounds that people of color do not need bike support. The staff members said that our objectives concerning communities of color were troubling because only campaigns that address the needs of jobs, food, and housing are considered primary concerns for communities of color. Despite this discouraging dismissal of our goals, we kept on working to build a vision of bicycling in LA that included invisible cyclists. Continuing to make connections between different types of organizations, we met with the board of the Bicycle Kitchen, a bike repair cooperative in East Hollywood and an important hub of LA's bike culture. The Bike Kitchen sent some cooks to hold a few bicycle maintenance workshops at Caresen, and in September 2009, cook Arlen Jones, City of Lights, and the Instituto de Educación Popular del Sur de California, or IDEPSCA, started BC Digna, a bike repair cooperative at IDEPSCA's downtown community job center. Now I'm going to switch over to talking about Ciclavia and show some videos from the first event we had in October 2010. And I think this video starts with an ad, so let me get that taken care of. Come on, ad. Show yourself. City of Lights aimed to support invisible cyclists, while Ciclavia aimed to get more people biking using culturally relevant promotion. I visited Bogota, Colombia in 2008 and participated in three instances of their famous car-free event known as Ciclovia, or Bike Way. The Ciclovia takes place every Sunday from 7 a.m. till 2:30 p.m. During this time, many major thoroughfares are either entirely closed to motor vehicle traffic or have restricted lane use. This event started in 1974 and is the brainchild of Jaime Ortiz Mariño, a Colombian who was educated in Ohio. When I met with him at the Alcaldía, or City Hall, in Bogota in September 2008, he claimed that the Ciclovia has altered the landscape in Bogota. It has made the city safer for women and has generally changed the way people use public space there. It always faces opposition, but it has grown considerably since its early days, with major support from mayors Antanas Mockus and Enrique Peñalosa in the 90s and 2000s. Currently, it opens up about 75 miles of roads to citizens. When I returned from Bogota, I came together with a group of community members from the bike and environmental movements to strategize making a Ciclovia happen in LA. Our initial Ciclovia committee, which included environmental activists Jonathan Parfrey and Sandra Hamlet, traffic engineer Stephen Villavasso, graphic designer Colleen Corcoran, bike activist Bobby Gatta, and the same Allison who co-founded City of Lights, along with a number of others who came and went, we started meeting on a monthly basis in October 2008. I took minutes at meetings and attended public events to promote the project. Over time, we attracted interest from other prominent figures who knew about Ciclovias, including bike activist and artist Joe Linton and Aaron Paley, an event organizer and founder of Community Arts Resources LA. Having these different forms of expertise and people who were part of LA's activist, arts, political, and philanthropic networks took Ciclovia from an idea to a viable event. We also counted on LA's active social world of urban bicyclists to participate, presenting on Ciclovia at bike summits and working with local bike businesses to build support. Because Ciclovia is an unfamiliar term in the United States, other cities have chosen to call their Ciclovias things like Sunday parkways, summer streets, Sunday streets, and scenic Sundays. While these names provide a fine description of the event, they do not connect with the Spanish language origin of the term Ciclovia. Since we wanted to create a diverse event that brought together many Angelenos, and not least LA's many Latino transit and sidewalk users, we thought it would be best to create a hybrid term that kept the original name somewhat intact while suggesting something in the local context. Ciclavia incorporates several words, ciclovia, cicla, which is a slang term for a bicycle, LA, and via, which is commonly appended to street names in Southern California. Based on our research on ciclovias in other cities and the needs we thought it could address in LA, we wanted our ciclovia to take place in a densely populated area in order to involve as many local residents as possible. LA is well known for its lack of park space, and a ciclovia addresses this by creating a temporary linear park, so we decided to focus on neighborhoods that were known for their lack of park space. And we also thought of it as an opportunity to highlight existing infrastructure for people who didn't currently use transit and bikeways options in their neighborhoods. It's a well-known fact that there are a lot of people who live in LA who don't know that we have a subway system, for example. So we planned our route along the LA subway line. Because the committee was dedicated to including a range of people in the event, we wanted to close streets in multi-ethnic central LA rather than starting in a more eco-friendly but wealthy area such as Santa Monica. Along the same lines, we hope to get the city on board to make our event official, because that would make a bigger statement than just another environmental event. We secured Mayor Antonio Villaraigosa's tentative support in fall 2009, and in January 2010, we started meeting with city staff to manage the logistics for our first event. In one meeting, a supervisor from the Department of Transportation told us that the streets were made for parking and travel. They weren't made for an event. Later, the same individual rejected a section of the proposed route that would divert motorists from a surface street onto a highway, informing us that we don't force people to get on the freeways. Some people don't feel comfortable driving on the freeway. The message was that the Department of Transportation recognized that people might fear driving, but accommodated this through keeping surface streets open to them, rather than improving conditions for a range of transit options. Negotiating with the city further proved the need for an event that gave people the opportunity to feel comfortable outside of their cars on city streets. Ciclovía closed 7.5 miles of streets in LA from 11 a.m. until 3 p.m. on Sunday, October 10, 2010. Which is what all this footage has been from. An estimated 40,000 people rode bikes or walked along the route, which passed from historically Latino Boyle Heights in East LA through Little Tokyo and downtown LA into Central American MacArthur Park and Koreatown, ending at East Hollywood's Bicycle District, a hub for the cycling community in central Los Angeles. Since I left LA in February 2011, they have held two more events that attracted over 100,000 people. I'm looking forward to attending the next Ciclovía on April 15th. So now I'm going to put up a map of the first event that shows all the different neighborhoods that we went through. Last summer, I visited LA for a press conference celebrating the opening of a bike lane on 7th Street, which is a backbone of Ciclovía's route. Let's see along here. It runs parallel to Wilshire Boulevard and has been a popular unofficial route for bicyclists for a long time. The Bike Coalition and the Bus Riders Union have launched a campaign to get the Department of Transportation to prioritize striping bike lanes on streets in low-income neighborhoods, focusing on multicultural 7th Street. As they say on the website for the Bike Coalition, 7th Street is an essential place to have bike lanes because it's in an area where many residents cannot afford cars and rely on public transportation, walking, or bicycling to get to work or downtown. A campaign promotional video showed bicyclists speaking in English, Spanish, and Korean, languages commonly heard along the street. City of Lights brought Latino cyclists into the scope of LA's bike planning. Ciclovía created a temporary imagining of bike-friendly streets. The new bike lane on 7th Street shows the impact that human infrastructure can have on permanent street design. In the early 20th century, the city of Los Angeles developed a plan for a highway system that took the shape of the existing city into account. However, funds dried up, and it was not until years later that the state built freeways across the urban landscape with no local participation in terms of planning where the freeways were going to go. As noted by transportation historian Martin Wax, many have observed that the freeways of Los Angeles are terribly destructive of a sense of community, that they cut swatches out of the urban fabric and provide barriers to community cohesion by creating enormous discontinuities through the city, especially in inner-city minority communities. It is not clear that the older local plan would have avoided all the social disruption and alienation that we have come to associate with the construction of the freeway system, but it is clear that the plan had different goals and priorities, which on the surface seem to imply that Los Angeles might be a significantly different place had that plan been fully implemented. End quote. Installing new physical infrastructure without taking human infrastructure into account is like laying down a freeway in a city without consulting local experts. Changes to built environments without local participation can have a disorienting effect on the people who live in them. Lynch cautioned that changes are often disturbing to the citizen emotionally and tend to disorganize his perceptual image. The role of the planner is in maintaining a visible structure and sense of continuity, even while massive changes are occurring. Experts such as urban planners, architects, and engineers use infrastructure to organize flows of movement. Mapping out the human infrastructure that also orders those flows might be a good starting point for effective bike projects. Finding ways to connect bicycling with local ideas about what makes a neighborhood a good place to live is a different project than redeveloping communities to make them more walkable or bike-friendly. As bike advocates in LA, even as we believed that making our urban neighborhoods more bike-friendly would benefit all residents, we were sometimes seen as outsiders. Giving diverse communities opportunities that are open to many forms of participation, like ciclovias, creates a space where people can reflect on their everyday transportation practices. If people do not have the opportunity to experience the affective differences of bicycling in a safe environment, they may not get what transportation bicycling is about and how much of a community building practice it can be. Now, in the midst of my dissertation write-up, I think of my LA adventures as phase one, showing me on the ground what effective human infrastructure for bicycling can look like. I'm currently engaged in a project in Seattle that is phase two, going to community-based organizations to find out how communities of color define bicycling. Funded by the Bicycle Alliance of Washington and BikeWorks, this project has me networking with environmental justice groups and learning about tensions related to bicycling in Seattle's marginal neighborhoods. We need to promote an idea of bicycling that falls in between the extremes of elite recreational cycling and biking as a last resort, a kind of bicycling that does not yet exist in many places. Bike-friendly neighborhoods feel safe because there is better communication between road users and more road users consider themselves to be part of what's going on in the street. Many organizations work to foster these kinds of quality public spaces, and connecting with their underlying values might get around the bias toward bicyclists as outsiders rather than regular people who ride bikes. Thank you.
So we'll open it up to questions now, and Adonia, I'll let you choose whoever raises their hand. And remember to use the microphone.
So currently Portland has a little bit of a funding battle with its Sunday parkways, and it's experiencing less contributions from the public funds, and it's going to have to rely on more from the private sector. So I was curious what the current funding pattern for LA's Cyclovia is.
I don't know what the current funding pattern is, but for the first event, we basically had a deal where we raised half the funds through private foundations, and then the city kicked in the other half. And so I don't know what subsequent arrangements have been. But I know that other cities have used a hybrid of public and private as well. I'll have to look into that when I'm down there in April. Back there?
Yeah, I was just wondering if you could say what was the change in factors that went from not getting approval for this ciclovia to actually having the event, if there was any just change in perception or major whatever it might have been.
Well, I think I guess I can talk about the mayor, like how the mayor's idea about it and support for it seemed to change over the time we were pursuing it. So we contacted the mayor's office in the fall of 2009 and pitched the idea and, met with some staffers, not with the mayor himself or anything like that. And then I think it was December of 2009, there was a climate summit in Copenhagen, and the mayor was there, and he got interviewed on a radio show, and the DJ asked him something like, so what are you doing in LA to promote bicycling? And he said something like, oh, well, we're going to have this street closure event where, you know, we get people out to blah, blah, blah. And so, you know, someone tipped us off to that, and we thought, great. So we had brought this thing to his attention, and then there was this moment where it was a politically salient thing for him to promote, and so that helped us inch a little bit further along the road to making it happen. And then we continued working with them into 2010, but there was this really interesting thing that happened in the summer of 2010 where the mayor, who is a recreational cyclist and rides around LA, got menaced by a motorist and fell off his bike and injured himself. And so there was all this fallout with all the bike people in LA being like, ha-ha, look, you see, biking here is not so safe, blah, blah, blah. And so the mayor was like, okay, you guys can have your day. Come down to Metro. Everybody can have 2 minutes to tell me about issues with bicycling. So it was a mayor's bike summit. And at that, he definitely mentioned Ciclovia as something that he'd already been working on, you know, that was pro-bicycling. So this had already been on his agenda for a while. So it seemed like it was, not only did we have a really good set of people working on the project who were very well connected in different arenas in LA, but also just public opinion was shifting enough, and the political salience of supporting green stuff kind of helped us move the thing along and make it happen. I think you were.
So the city of LA, they don't have any kind of a bike plan?
They do have a bike plan. They do. They were updating their master plan during the time that I was living there. I think that that plan dated from, or the last time they'd done an update was 1996. And so they had had a plan prior to that, possibly, but I'm not 100% sure. But yeah, they do have a plan.
When you mentioned that there were the people you found who were riding like without tubes in their bikes and things like that, did you find that was because they couldn't afford to maintain their bikes, or they just didn't know how? And did you consider like offering like little printed manuals or like brochures on basic bike maintenance, maybe in Spanish or Korean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we did workshops on basic bike maintenance in Spanish, and we put together some different materials around that. But I think it was mostly an issue of affordability. Because there were a number of bike shops in that part of LA that served the Latino community, and so it didn't seem like knowledge was lacking so much as access to tools and also access to materials. Because a lot of the people that we were working with ended up being volunteers at this bike co-op because they already knew some stuff about wrenching, or it was, you know, something that they were able to spend time learning.
A lot of this seems to be revolving around this particular event, but I'm wondering if there was any efforts or, I guess, stories about how you engage children into this, or this was something that was basically translated through parents, or whether there was some sort of outreach effort directed at schools or kids specifically?
For Ciclavia, I'm trying to remember if we were directly targeting children. There are a lot of teenage cyclists in LA. It's fixies, like brightly colored fixies, are really popular in the neighborhood where I lived in Koreatown. So you saw like groups of young guys riding their bikes around at night. I mean, in general, group rides are a very visible phenomenon in LA. There's this group called the Midnight Riders that has a website where anybody can post a ride, and then you get these, you know, you're just standing on the sidewalk, and all of a sudden there's 40 super fashionable people riding past you. And then they're gone. And in the part of town where I lived, sometimes they were made up of teenagers. So we knew that we were going to be connecting with those kinds of kids. But I don't remember if in our early efforts we were thinking about going to elementary schools and whatnot. And that might have developed since then, too. So.
Mm-hmm. Well, on the other side of that spectrum, I'm interested in getting older adults biking more. I mean, do you feel like this human infrastructure could be extended to that community with results?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I would be very curious, you know, to know what older adults are thinking about bicycling now and how they see it, like what they see as the barriers to their own bicycling. Is that something that in Portland has been part of the Sunday Parkways community?
I have a question more from a researcher perspective and your methods, because in the audience we have mainly planners and engineers who are not perhaps as familiar with using more ethnographic methods. And in particular, I'm curious, because you really make a distinction between, I love the quote in the beginning, bicyclists and people who ride bikes, and these two very different communities. And then you're coming into the community, particularly trying to reach the people who ride bikes part of the community. But you're coming in as an academic, which is sort of viewed as a more elite or something. I'm wondering if that was a problem, or if it was, how you overcame it, or if maybe it wasn't a problem trying to reach that community.
I think for me, because I'm an anthropologist, people don't know what that means. So I got to kind of occupy this weird gray zone where they weren't really sure what I was doing or what I wanted. And I ended up feeling like that gave me a lot of leeway because people weren't expecting me to make promises I couldn't keep, like, you know, a city planner or a city official or something like that. And I also, you know, was sort of I was part of the community that I was researching. So that gave me, I think, showed that I was invested in having some integrity in how I was dealing with people and stuff like that. But yeah, largely anthropology, I mean, does it make you think of dinosaurs or potsherds? Mostly, I don't think people, I don't think it alienated them too much, just because they didn't have a clear image in their mind of what I was supposed to be anyway, so.
Mm-hmm. Was there an effort to reach out to minority women as opposed to men?
That is, that's like a whole other subject that I feel like I, the question of gender in bicycling in general is something that has come up in my field work just around the position of women in various bike movements that I've been part of. But in Los Angeles, there were very few minority women who were bicycling. And the various theories I heard as to why that was women oftentimes were in charge of childcare, so they were taking kids with them on the bus, and so they couldn't be biking. I think that there are also some cultural barriers to women bicycling in terms of exposure, and the fact that as a bicyclist you have to be fairly assertive, and maybe it was asking women to take on a you have to be okay with being assertive in public, and maybe in some cultures that's not really something women are expected to do, or it's not considered appropriate. But this was not something that I got to deal with directly in my research, and there needs to be much more research and promotion in that area.
Mm-hmm.
So to answer,
I think I can talk
loud
enough. Can you?
It's for
okay.
the web. It's
oh, I'm sorry. Okay. So yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so maybe to answer the lady's questions about minority women cycling, maybe to give you a little bit more background, there's been the theory that minority women have been said that it's got a lot to do with their hair. And really, as a minority, a black woman, sometimes it is the hair. That's a long story in and of itself. But I think there are also just other cultural issues, whether it's because maybe we didn't grow up riding bikes, maybe it was more of an economic reason. I don't think it has much to do with the assertiveness that maybe you suggested, Adonia. I think it really has to do more with our physical, our own physical selves, our hair, the ability to buy a bike. There are other reasons why I've heard. I don't agree. I ride bikes. I have a great bike. I have two bikes. I love cycling. I'm a fair weather rider, though. I'm not the advocate that goes out and rides, you know, 365 days a year. And I don't let those things stop me, but some of my other friends have allowed those things to stop them from riding their bikes.
Cool. Thanks for that insight.
I have a question regarding the public hearings you were talking about, seeing that pushback from high-income communities about being afraid that they would draw undesirables. I was wondering what you saw the other way around, if you saw the low-income communities having a pushback because they didn't want their neighborhoods to be gentrified, and what your experience
was
with that.
I think that's been happening a lot more recently. There was one encounter I had in LA where I was at a talk by Jeanette Sadikon. You guys know who she is, Transportation Commissioner in New York. And she had this great talk that was all about this great bike stuff they were doing in New York, and you know, all the bike people in the audience were just like, yes, yes, this is so great. And in the Q&A, this African-American young man stood up and was like, they're putting in bike lanes in my neighborhood, and now all these outsiders are coming in, and now we can't afford to live there, so how do bike lanes benefit me? And there was just not really a response. And so that was one of the first things that really tipped me off to, oh, so we've got opposition in wealthy neighborhoods, and we've got opposition in lower income neighborhoods, so what the heck is going on here? So a big part of my project more recently has just been trying to promote the idea that bicycling means a lot of different things, and that there's not a consistent or coherent image of bicycling, and so it's important to just get laid out at the beginning when you're dealing with a community group or you know, an individual or whatever, what the image of bicycling is in their minds. I recently just co-founded a network of researchers who study bike cultures so that we can start to collaborate more in talking about the fact that there are many meaningful worlds around bicycling, and that it's very challenging to even talk about it in consistent terms because of these wildly different ideas that people have about what a bicyclist is or like what it represents.
Mm-hmm. So I want to piggyback on a couple of these parts about bicyclists and infrastructure and some of the connections, and something that I'm trying to make sense of is similar questions, like what's the relationship and what are these different identities and how's it evolved to be something that is benefiting or for some part of the population and not benefiting or not for another part. And what I've kind of come up with so far, and I'm curious what other people think about this, is I think the general strategy in planning is to put infrastructure where you're going to get the best return on investment, and that means that it's going to be helping people to get downtown, professionals to ride to the core parts of the cities, and that generally that's working really well in places like Portland and other areas, and so that's a real success story. But what has happened is that the whole bicycle economy has really grown up around that audience, that market, and that means that the products and the services and the programs and everything is designed for those folks and not for the rest of the community. And I think that translates to everything from like helmet design and bike design and products, you know, like the clothing. And I think it's really interesting because it's very complex. I think the opportunity is to think about this, like the human infrastructure piece, and how you create different kinds and different levels of quote-unquote economy. Things like the bike co-ops, I think, are huge opportunities. And then connecting all the dots, not leaving anybody out of the conversation, because we all contribute something to the whole picture. And I think we have just constructed part of the picture so far. And the work is to really build out the rest of it in a more equitable way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I definitely think that a lot of the pushback that bicycling is getting is the fact that it is a subcultural thing. You know, like the bike culture that I participate in and that lots of people I know participate in is just one aspect of bicycling. But then that kind of gets seen as what bicycling is. And so, you know, all of this like hipster bashing, you know, disliking of young urban culture or whatever, bicycling just gets kind of thrown in with that and then dismissed as something that has value in other ways.
So. And I think it's because it's subculture of the dominant culture. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So we have a couple questions from our web viewers.
I accidentally skipped this guy a couple times with hands. Can we?
Sorry, web viewers. My question is if you can talk some about the successes and challenges of linking the kind of bike subculture that we were just discussing, sort of youth, activist, and the cyclists who were, you know, just biking. And not cyclists, people who are riding bikes for out of necessity. And the second part of that question is there a way that we can kind of eavesdrop on that network you were talking about of people researching bike culture?
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll address the second part first. We're trying to figure that out. We're thinking, I mean, a number of us have blogs or websites, so we're thinking that we're just going to have one maybe feeder site, and we made that already. It's called bccultures.wordpress.com or .org. I don't remember what WordPress blogs are, but bccultures.wordpress. B-I-C-I, yeah. And so we're going to try to disseminate stuff through there. The first part, the really cool thing about L.A. and maybe about any really, really large city where you have a huge amount of different ethnic communities coexisting was that there were people who could actually cross between these different communities. There were lots of people who were in the bike movement in LA or who are just, you know, people who are riding bikes in LA but don't consider themselves activists or whatever, who are from immigrant families. And so they have ties to neighborhoods and communities that recreational cyclists who live in the suburbs don't have any access to. So City of Lights was able to build a lot of its participation through that, through having people who were bicultural, basically, and who were able to kind of go between being, you know, a bike activist fixie person, but also, you know, having grown up in a Latino community and knowing how to navigate going between those things and not basically working with people who weren't outsiders in either community.
So now we actually have three questions, basically, from the web on the similar same topic, and that's access to bikes and how much of a barrier that is, and if there's programs similar to Community Cycling Center that we have here that try to increase access to bikes amongst low-income communities.
I feel like access to bikes both is and isn't an issue. A lot of the people that we worked with in City of Lights had bikes. They weren't in good condition, and they maybe were going to fall apart the next day. But with the healthy stolen bike economy that goes on there, you can get a bike for pretty cheap. I mean, $20, something like that. So it wasn't, I don't think that was so much of an issue. But at the same time, there are a lot of resources there for people who want to build a bike, like the various bike repair co-ops in LA, the Bike Kitchen, the Bike Oven, the Bike Microwave. there's a theme, isn't that nice? And then the LA County Bike Coalition also started another bike co-op. So City of Light started this thing called BC Digna, which is a bike co-op. I don't know that they, maybe at this point they have enough that you could build a bike from scratch, or maybe they have, I think that they're making refurbished bikes people can buy. But this other thing the Bike Coalition started, BC Libre, I think is another resource. So this stuff does exist in LA, Community Cycling Center style stuff.
So I love what LA has done with Ciclovia. I help organize Portland Sunday Parkways, and I do want people to know that we do a lot of work behind the scenes with community groups, Elders in Action, Latino communities, African American, immigrant and refugee communities, to get them to come out to Sunday Parkways, because it's about building that community. It's not necessarily about the bike, but it's about being part of the public space and the community of Portland. And just as a plug, if you ever want to organize anything, be free. It's a community event. So thank you.
Okay, great. So on that note, I'll bring this to a close. And thank you very much for coming down and speaking with us.
Thank you.